Today on the Roundhouse, we're getting an update on what it takes to restore a Redding T1. All aboard!
In days past, the Roundhouse was where the railroad worker united with the steam locomotive, each to prepare for the journey ahead. Today, it's where we examine the history, the industry, the machines, the hobby, and the passion behind railroading. News, interviews, stories, and more. So climb aboard. This is The Roundhouse.
Welcome to The Roundhouse. I'm your host, Nick Ozarak, and this is episode number 135 of our Trains and Railroading podcast, where we're talking about everything in the industry and the hobby. You name it, and we discuss it. The Roundhouse is a presentation of Streamliner Media. Go to streamlinermedia.com to see how we can help your marketing efforts, especially when it comes to video. Today, we are talking to Rob Gardner. He is the president of American Steam Railroad Preservation Association. We're catching up on what's transpired with the restoration of T1 number 2100, a Redding steam locomotive. Over the past 8 years, we'll be talking with them about why they've made the decision to switch from coal to oil for firing the locomotive and what the future has in store. Before we get to that, though, I'd like to thank those of you who are supporting The Roundhouse on Patreon. Go to patreon.com/theroundhouse. For as little as a dollar a month, you're supporting the podcast and what we do here, and I appreciate that very much. I'd also like to thank the sponsors of today's episode. First, the Strasburg Railroad. Learn more about how their mechanical services department can help with your restoration project by emailing mechanical@strasburgrailroad.com. And Rail and Road Auctions, which specializes in railroad collectibles and memorabilia. You can see what auctions they have coming up at bidrar.com. Our guest today is the president of American Steam Railroad Preservation Association. You may remember way back in the first year of the Roundhouse, we were talking with these guys about their restoration of Redding T1 number 2100. And now a lot has transpired since then. So we're here to get a little bit more information on that. Please welcome to the Roundhouse, Mr. Rob Gardner.
Well, thank you, Nick. Appreciate you making time to catch up with us, and looking forward to sharing the latest. And I don't know if you probably recall where we were and the rate of speed we were moving the last time we talked. We were on the Northeast Corridor at better than 100 miles per hour.
Yes, yeah, that was the Steel City Limited, which was also a podcast episode. Yeah, that was 5 years ago or so. So yes, both of us are a little bit more stationary today in that regard. But your restoration is anything but stationary. So let's step back, though, because some folks might not be familiar with it. So if you could provide us with an overview of the project and kind of some of the highlights over the past 7 years since we talked about it.
Sure. So yeah, back in 2015, we moved the 2100 to Ohio from Washington State. We'd entered into a lease agreement with the owner of the engine, moved it here. That was quite an undertaking in and of itself. And, you know, we got to work, you know, stripping the thing down, satisfying ourselves what we were dealing with. And, you know, we discovered, like with most locomotive restorations, that there's always a little more to the story than what you may have been planning on first glimpse. Much like somebody buys a 100-year-old century home, you really don't know what you get into until you have it in your possession and you can really get your hands on it and really start, you know, peeling away the layers, so to speak. So, you know, most of these first 7 years have been addressing some shortcomings in the firebox. We replaced both of the inner side sheets, roughly 5 feet by 10 foot patches, starting at the mud ring, working our way up, most of the way up the sides. And, you know, we had discovered that the side sheets most likely were reflecting some original repairs dating back to before these boilers were on the T1 chassis, when they were the I-10 280s prior to World War II. So we think the Reading had probably engaged in some repairs that were good for them at the time, but in today's day and age, we figured we better you know, address the thickness of these side sheets. So we've got, you know, brand new stay bolts and a lot of new caps, new mudring rivets. We hydroed the boiler and proven that those repairs are good, and we're done with the work in the firebox, essentially. We have one patch to address one of the thermic siphons. But as far as the major repairs, the firebox is done. You know, over the course of these 7 years, then the current boiler ticket had expired on the locomotive. So now we're, you know, our big push is to retube the boiler. You know, our big progress or our big success in the last probably 30 to 60 days is we got the blessing of the FRA to, we didn't have to pull all the flues, the superheater flues out. We had taken a lot of readings, UT readings on those, you know, met with the FRA, showed them how we went about it. They'd given us some pointers on what they wanted to see. And they said, you know, proven that, you know, these are well above the factor of safety of four for the operating pressure we plan to use. So with that, you know, we've removed the 2-inch tubes. We've had gotten the funding to order them, bought those from Anderson Tube. They arrived late June. So we're working on final repairs to the front and rear tube sheet to be ready to put the new tubes in. And our current fundraising focus is on the money we need to actually roll and expand and seal weld the new tubes into the boiler. So there are other peripheral areas of the restoration that are upcoming, but really the boiler is the focus. You know, and some people may ask the question with the 15-year clock that will start ticking when we get the tubes installed, why aren't you doing that last? Well, you know, can't always orchestrate the flow of how you want things to go, especially when you're dealing with outside funding sources. So in our case, you know, we're wanting to get the boiler done to satisfy, you know, a primary supporter of the project, but we're pretty confident that the rest of the project will pick up in pace as we wrap up the boiler. Because the good news is that the running gear does not need a lot of work. It will not be like, you know, replacing side sheets in the firebox. So we're pretty optimistic that we won't see too much of that 15-year clock get used up before we're able to start, you know, with test runs and stuff like that. So
from looking at your website, we're recording this in August of 2023. Your website says that you're only $170,000 from completing your fundraising goal of $700,000. So that would further suggest that you're optimistic that the fundraising is coming in at a pace that even once you're starting that clock, that you'll be able to continue pace with the work up to the point of operation.
Correct. Yeah. We've, you know, with the volunteer hours we've invested in this locomotive, have just about reached $1 million in equivalent value if you were hiring, you know, professional contractors. So the amount of work we've put into the engine is pretty significant. You know, I think it's fair to say we're on the backside of the project to get the engine back in service. And, you know, obviously the locomotive, you know, like I said, we've uncovered a few more things than we expected to find in the beginning. But I'd say we're well over the hump of the hardest work being behind us. So yes, with the pace of the fundraising, I feel we'll be able to keep moving along at a pretty good clip here in the next 6 to 12 months.
Something that you've just recently announced as well is the fact that this locomotive that historically was a coal burner, that had a previous conversion to oil firing, that then when you took ownership of the locomotive was going to be converted back to fire coal, is now going to be converted to fire on oil. What were the factors that led to the decision of that conversion?
Well, yeah, over the course of these last 7 years, a lot has changed in the world we live in, right? We've been through COVID, we've come out of COVID, that's had its own share of challenges. environmentally, we're seeing challenges that probably are not going to change a whole lot when it comes to fossil fuels and what you're burning in a steam locomotive. Obviously, there's still a lot of locomotives burning coal. And I think if you look at those venues and those locomotives, if you own your own railroad, own your own cars, pretty much control your own destiny on a day in and day out basis, if you want to burn coal, you can continue to burn coal. In our situation, because we don't plan to have our own property, our own railroad, our own train set, our own insular operation, so to speak, when you start looking around the industry, you start to see some challenges. How are we going to handle ash abatement? The cost of coal itself continues to go up at a pretty steady rate. If you look over in England, we've even seen in the last year concern that they can't even source coal within their own boundaries, right? They're even looking at having to import coal for the heritage railroad industry over there. We're not quite at that point here, but simply the cost of the coal, the handling of it, the getting rid of the ash, just continue to create a lot of economic challenges that when we ran the numbers over the last 6 months or so, it became pretty clear to us that we could burn recycled oil much more effectively and eliminate a lot of headaches and hassles than if we were to try to go back to coal. So it was a bit of a a gut check moment for us, because we knew what the numbers said, but we also knew what we've been telling everybody for the last 7 years. And so we wouldn't be where we are today without the support we've had for these last 7 years. And I'm confident that, you know, as the observer and supporter of our projects look around, that they will be understanding of how we arrived at this decision. It wasn't an easy decision by any means. I mean, I'm from the East, so I'm all about burning coal. You know, if we were talking about an engine out West, it would be a lot easier to say, well, yeah, they probably burned oil at some point in time, so it's no big deal. So, you know, and we understand people are probably going to have some questions about that. We'll continue to field those questions and explain, you know, how we arrived at this decision the best we can. And, you know, we're hopeful and confident that people will still want to come out and enjoy the locomotive, you know, regardless of what it's burning, you know. So.
Certainly, because at the end of the day, it's still a steam locomotive.
Yeah.
And it's still something that's going to have a tremendous draw to it.
Right.
Because of the size and the scope of it as well.
Yep.
The Strasburg Railroad is an institution in the heritage railroad industry, and its mechanical services department is proud to lead the way. With the knowledge and experience that has created one of the most reliable steam railroading experiences in the country, the Strasburg Railroad is excited to offer their expertise to the rest of the industry. Strasburg's professional team provides consulting and technical assistance to take your steam locomotive or rail car project from idea to finished product. They stand behind their work and always strive to meet their customers' needs for quality, historic accuracy, and reliability at a price that is fair. Unlike many competitors, they feature a fully equipped boiler, rail car, and machine shop, so the work gets done in-house, helping you get more for your money. Send your inquiries to mechanical@strasburgrailroad.com and let the professionals get to work for you. Jenny Callen asks, you mentioned in that the challenges of COVID, and Jenny asks, what has been the hardest part of the restoration in terms of moving from being in the pandemic to moving back into normal life?
I mean, the pandemic in and of itself, of course, created a delay, right? We lost momentum. We lost the ability to gather on a regular basis. And as soon as we and our landlord, you know, understood that we had a means to be able to start meeting again and working on the locomotive, we did. Obviously, and the great thing is that within our ranks of volunteers and our membership, everybody was literally just sitting there waiting for the word to come back to work. You know, I can't say that we lost too many people that found something else to do in their spare time. We've had an incredible group of very dedicated volunteers who were basically just waiting for the word to say we could get back to work on the locomotive. So with anything, I think the biggest challenge was the pace of the fundraising. We had some really good progress at the start of COVID, but the longer COVID wore on, I think a lot of the U.S. population was starting to experience some level of financial challenges that I think a lot of organizations like ours would say, yeah, it was a challenge. You know, the cash coming in on a weekly, monthly, annual basis slipped. And that's tough to recover from in the short term. It's a long-term process. So we've just continued to rely on social media, our regular monthly video updates, the open houses that we're now having again with Midwest that, you know, allow them to feature their projects and we get to feature and show people up close what we're doing on the 2100. And we continue to gain new members. Another plus is that our membership has continued to climb all along. You know, we've been very pleased with the steady increase in membership we've seen over the last 12 to 24 months. So, but you know, in the end, the fundraising is always the biggest challenge, and COVID certainly set us back in that regard. So we're still, you know, I would say it's just, it probably added at least 12 to 24 months to our project as a result. So.
Certainly understandable. You mentioned in there the video updates. As a video guy, I really appreciate them. And your volunteer effort, yes, it's clear you have a dedicated team. But as a video guy, I really appreciate the efforts of Nick Martin, who's putting those together. Because sure. It's just such a great job of introducing folks to the cast of characters involved with this, as well as being able to see this work that's going on rather than just read about it.
Yeah, it's a real blessing that we have people like Nick that have the talent, the drive, the knack to, it's his sweet spot. You know, he shows up and he, you know, he's got a great routine. He prepares any of us who are taking part in a shoot. I still get incredibly nervous when the camera's when I'm in front of the camera and I, you know, the number of takes that it requires to get it. Where we look at each other and say, okay, I think that's good. You know, oh no, we can't use that. That I totally tripped over all my words there, you know? So the only thing I wish we had were like really big cue cards with like 6-inch font letters with everything spelled out, you know, a teleprompter would be great, but we have to resort to just, you know, being calm, cool, and collected and remembering what you're trying to convey, you know?
That, and it's all about authenticity. It's all about the fact that this is who you guys are. This is what you're actually doing, which I think that element to relate is really key as well.
Someday we will probably have a really fun night of watching all the blooper reels of all the outtakes that didn't make it to the final versions. So,
well, and be sure to share that fun with the rest of us. I look forward to seeing that blooper reel.
Yes, yes.
So, looking at some of the questions that came in from you guys listening, there were a number that centered around the fact that one of the things that changed in the 8 years since you embarked on this restoration is that the Reading and Northern Railroad began and completed their restoration of one of the other T1 locomotives. So there were a number of questions centering around that. The first one from Kenny Broomfield: how has the team with the Reading Northern and the operating T1-2102 have helped or given pointers to your restoration efforts?
Well, we have a really, really solid relationship with Ryan Bosher and the Fredricksons and the whole team there, right on up to Andy Muller. They're great people. They've actually called us with some questions on things like, hey, could you measure this on the 2100? We're wanting to compare and figure out maybe what was the way the Reading did it, because we think this has been changed along the way. So, you know, we call them on a regular basis to ask, okay, how did you do this? You know, or who did you use for this service? If it's something really specialized, they're very genuine, down to earth guys there. We do look forward to hopefully a future where, you know, while there's nothing concrete, nothing, you know, we're just not quite to that point yet. I think we kind of have a feeling that there may be a future with the two engines together out that way in Eastern PA. And we're all looking forward to hopefully, you know, there are going to be a lot of challenges, a lot of expenses to figuring out how to make that happen. But, you know, if it's in the cards, you know, we're going to give it every effort to get there. You know, the Reading and Northern not only, you know, has been a great resource for, you know, intellectual information. Hey, do you have a drawing for this part? How did you do that? You know, they gave us a really nice donation, you know, in the completing their firebox work on the 2102. They had all new grates made, all new grate bearers made, just about everything to do with the grate system. They had brand new patterns made and new castings. We were the beneficiary of a very kind donation of a brand new fire door frame casting. It's like an upside down C shape that goes around the sides and over the top of the fire door opening, and you mount the air cylinder to it that opens the clamshell doors. So we're looking forward to, you know, completing the machining of that casting and putting we bought new fire doors through the Nashville Steam Group. With the help of FMW, they were having new Franklin fire doors made for a few locomotives. So we're fabricating a new air cylinder, and that'll all go together as a new assembly. You know, we're going to keep the look of the coal burner set up, even though we'll be burning oil. And then also, as they were, you know, going about their conversion, you know, they've donated a few other small parts here and there to us that have been a big help. So. Really good guys, and we look forward to, you know, hopefully get to spend a little more time with them, you know, over the next few years.
Certainly exciting, and certainly a rare kind of situation, because so often these steam locomotives that are being restored to operation, they may be the only survivor, or they're a survivor of a class, but it's the only one that's being put back into operation. So it's sort of an unusual situation. As a result of that, Nathan Aaron asks, given that there is already another Reading T1 in operation, why restore this locomotive instead of focusing efforts on another locomotive?
Well, that's a very good question. You know, the two answers to that. I mean, number one, at the time the opportunity came along to get involved with the life of the 2100, Reading and Northern had not announced their restoration of the 2102 yet. I think we might have been hearing some rumblings, but it was, I would say, about 12 months after we'd really kicked off our project that it kind of became open public knowledge that Andy wanted to return the 02 to steam. So, you know, over those years, it was like, well, are we going to get there first, or is he going to get there? I mean, we all kind of knew, yeah, he's probably going to beat us to the finish line, but, you know, we've been excited watching that transpire all along. You know, quite frankly, still, when you look at the 2100 versus the Frisco 1352, this engine still requires far less work than the 1352 will require. We do want to see the 1352 back in steam, but this was just quite simply the logical engine to start with when you put the two side by side. So had we had to do all over again, I'd say we'd still be doing it the way we're doing it. So, and yes, while the rail fan interest level and attention is kind of fickle at times when there are two identical engines running of the same class, I think you look at places like Durango and Silverton, Coombrace and Toltec, and a few other places where there are multiple engines of the same heritage that, you know, there's still a lot of people in our neck of the woods in the Midwest that will want to come see the 2100 because it's 4 hours, 5 hours closer to them than the Reading and Northern. I mean, I've been over to see the O2, and a lot of people have flocked to see it. I still think we'll still be a pretty substantial attraction for people that want to see steam in the Midwest. You know, in the end, it is a steam locomotive, and it will garner a lot of support and a lot of interest when we're making steam and pulling people down the track.
It certainly will. Brian J. Smith asks, being that the operating environment on the main lines can be a feast or famine affair, how do you plan on sustaining the operation, even if the opportunity to visit another tourist railroad isn't in the cards for maybe years at a time? Are there other ways ASR can generate revenue?
There certainly are. You know, obviously within the facility where we're working on the 2100, I think we'll have the opportunity to do, you know, hand at the throttle, engineer for an hour type programs, fireman for an hour, you know, sit in the jump seat for an hour, you know, all things that will help, you know, cater to people based on how much money they have available for such an experience. You know, that will certainly be, I think, something we'll be undertaking even before we leave the property to go out for any break-in runs. And I'd say there's probably still a lot of unanswered questions in that arena. Quite honestly, our focus has just been get the 2100 done. You know, we've been developing a relationship with the Cuyahoga Valley Scenic Railroad over the last 1 to 2 years. And of course, you know, they, like us, they have their own sets of challenges that were imposed on them with COVID that they're working through. Other challenges, you know, with the park service and some physical challenges on the property itself that they're working through. We're confident that, you know, by the time we're ready to go, they've given us verbal support that, hey, we get it. You're a few miles up the track. It would make sense that when you're ready to go, that we'll be working together to get this engine some track time to really get it, you know, broken in. It's really not a mystery that, you know, that would be the place to go. And all indications are pointing in that direction, that that's where our initial operations will be. You know, we have no formal operating agreements with anybody quite yet. We're just not quite to that point of making things official and permanent, but, you know, we are optimistic that CVSR will be a part of our future.
Aiden Shineman asks, do you guys plan on building a complex similar to what Kentucky Steam Heritage Corp is doing with CNO 2716?
Well, I think any group with a steam locomotive would love to have a roundhouse to be in. I mean, we've got the Age of Steam that's a little over an hour down the road in Sugar Creek. You know, we love seeing what Kentucky Steam is embarking on down there in Kentucky. We've got a good home with Midwest. Yeah, the locomotive and tender won't fit in the roundhouse or on the turntable the way it is, but we could be working outside in the elements 12 months out of the year, and we're not. And that being said, we have a great rapport with the Midwest people. We're helping one another out. We're encouraging one another. We're sharing information and contacts. Who do you turn to do this when you're doing it on your locomotive, you know? I'm very confident that roundhouse at West 3rd Street in Cleveland can become an even more impressive venue for steam than it is right now. Obviously, there's no regular operating steam there. There hasn't been operating steam in that roundhouse for a few years now. But all things point in the direction that could be a place where you could see more steam on a more regular basis in the future. Obviously, you know, they're just getting started on the process with the 4070. We only want to see them do better over time as we seek to, you know, improve our capabilities and what we're doing with the 2100. So, yeah, it would be great to see another brand new roundhouse and turntable get built, but it takes a lot of money to pull that off. It is a very cash intensive proposition. And I think for now we're content to, that this is our home and we love being there, and we're looking forward to seeing the venue continue to spawn more volunteers, more training, more qualification, of bringing in people that have a lot of the skills we need, and also helping younger people develop more skills and talents in those areas, and those that have the interest to come and learn how to weld, learn how to, what does it mean to use a grinder, you know, how to properly grind an area on a locomotive, and machining technologies. They've got a full machine shop there, just about a full machine shop, and it's their shop capabilities have improved drastically in the last 12 months. So a lot of good things going on there at the Roundhouse on West 3rd Street. So,
and so cool that you have your restoration going on right next to Midwest Railway Preservation Society, which is working on Grand Trunk Western number 4070. Not too often you have two steam locomotives being restored at the same time in a historic roundhouse.
Definitely. And I think if you look at a template for, I guess, what I was just kind of sharing verbally, is what has happened in Portland between Doyle McCormick and the Daylight Group, the 700 Group, and this project with the ORNN Pacific 197. There's evidence of multiple groups working together, you know, over the course of many years, helping each other out, helping each other get better over time. That to me is kind of the blueprint philosophically for what I see happening in Cleveland. And I'm excited to see that just continue to blossom and flourish over the next few years. And I'm a huge fan of the 4070. I was born and raised 35 minutes from the roundhouse. So as a little kid at about the age of 6 or 7, the first big steam engine I ever experienced was 4070 on the Cuyahoga Valley line. And, you know, aside from our project, I can't wait to see 4070 start coming together and seeing their fundraising taking off and to see their projects as they start, you know, renewing the running gear, renewing the boiler. They're going to build a brand new tender tank for the tender. You know, these things take time and they take money, and very rarely do they happen overnight.
Absolutely true. It is certainly a game of patience. Part of that patience too. So, you mentioned at the top of the interview that you worked with the owner of the locomotive. And from my understanding, the locomotive is still privately owned. I understand that the owner wishes to remain anonymous. Is there a particular reason why they choose to be an anonymous owner in this situation?
Other than for the fact that it's a business operation for him, it's just business. You know, he's not a rail fan. You know, he had relationships with people who were a little more like us, and the locomotive serves a purpose for him, and that's basically, you know, I think the long and the short of it. It's a business decision that he chooses to have the locomotive, and we've had a really good relationship with him over these first 7 years, and the relationship continues to evolve as the project evolves. So, that's really all I know about it, you know, to be honest. So he's been a great supporter of our efforts, and he wants to see the engine back in steam. So
this episode of The Roundhouse is brought to you by Rail and Road Auctions. You can find all types of railroad collectibles, including signs, signals, horns, locks, keys, lanterns, timetables, passes, and more. With opening bids of only $10 on many lots, you'll be sure to find something to add to your collection or train room. Rail and Road also offers fast and easy shipping right to your doorstep, and they combine multiple live and online sales methods to allow you a variety of purchasing options. Their book auction closes on June 5th, 2023, with nearly 600 books available, all with a $5 starting bid. I took a look through this myself, and there's definitely some good titles in there. You can view the full auction now at www.bidrar.com. That's bidrar.com. Rail and Road Auctions, where real railroaders and rail fans build their collections. John Creasing asks, how will the locomotive be able to leave the property on its own wheels since CSX doesn't allow plane bearings?
Well, they do allow them. You know, 765 has come to the valley through Cleveland, literally right outside the roundhouse. You know, as we discussed a few minutes ago about, you know, the proximity of Cuyahoga Valley Scenic Railroad to the West 3rd Street Roundhouse does not require going out on a busy main line. So obviously that reality does change that part of the equation that there are agreements in place that can and will allow a steam locomotive to move from where we are down to the valley. Once the engine, you know, gets that roughly 1,000 miles of service under its belt, and we know that there's a reliability factor, you know, the other potential interested parties will be made aware of that. All the inspection and performance records are available for everybody to look at. And when the time comes and there are venues that are offline, so to speak, that are out of the immediate Cleveland area, we're reasonably confident that we'll be able to get there with the support of either Norfolk Southern or CSX. So,
Eric Fader asks, I applaud your efforts with 2100. When she's done, what are the plans with Frisco 1352, which is the locomotive you own and actually predates the whole 2100 project, as I understand it?
Yeah, it's kind of a bandwidth thing. There's really nothing standing in our way from saying we're going to start work on 1352, but it's a huge fundraising effort to raise the funds to move the locomotive, then to start raising the funds to invest, you know, the dollars and resources into the engine to get it restored. There's room at the roundhouse to do it. I'm sure it could, you know, if we said, hey, we're moving the engine next month and it'll be here, we'd be able to get it inside. But it's just a bandwidth thing. While our membership's growing, it's not really practical that we try to undertake two locomotive restorations at the same time. And I don't know of too many organizations that are working on 2 8 coupled locomotives simultaneously. It's a bit of, you know, we've had our hands full with this, you know, even to the outside observer saying, well, geez, you haven't made a whole, it doesn't seem at times like you made a lot of progress at certain points along the way. Our volunteers have been steadily working on things this entire time. Other than the time we couldn't physically be in the roundhouse during COVID, work has been ongoing, and there's no shortage of work to do. So even when we have 10, 12, 14 guys show up, there's very rarely people standing around saying, geez, I wish we had another project here to work on, you know? So we do intend to tackle 1352 as soon as the resources allow it. Manpower, cash on hand, you know, those all go hand in hand together. So
completely understandable. While the work did have to stop for a period, the fundraising never stopped. And I have to applaud the creative efforts. My personal favorite of your fundraising endeavors so far was when you were raffling off a Broadway Limited T1 model of the 2100. I did buy tickets for it. I did not get it. That made me sad. But a friend of mine actually got one of them. So I'm happy that at least I know the person who owns it.
Oh, that's cool.
So I like that out of the box thinking as far as how you're fundraising, because I think that keeps the interest fresh, especially when there may be times when there's either no progress going on or there is progress, but it's not the big news headlining grabbing stuff.
Sure, sure. Yeah, when you look at our fundraising and then you look at the things in our store, I think we have done a really, you know, not to pat certainly myself on the back, I have not come up with many of these ideas myself, but I think we've done a pretty good job of branding ourselves for a group that hasn't had an engine out running around for 30 or 40 years. To be a draw, I think we've succeeded in that regard, that we have created a following and people can show their support by buying hats, shirts, you know, old stables, pieces of the locomotive, taking part in our raffles that we've had. You know, we have another T1 to raffle off, so you're not totally, the door's not closed for you to win one, Nick.
Yes. Oh, good. That makes my day. Not that I'm even modeling Reading, but I'll find a purpose for it some way or another.
That has been a way that, you know, we kind of occupied ourselves through COVID, was coming up with creative ways to, you know, keep ourselves in front of as many people as possible, you know, and keep people, the awareness up within the rail fan and railroad community, so to speak. So, yeah, thank you. That's a lot of minds have gone into coming up with a lot of these out-of-the-box ideas. So
now I want to turn the attention to your mind specifically, Rob, which is you're president of this organization, and I imagine there's so much that comes along with the roles and responsibilities of overseeing the different elements, the mechanical, the finances, and whatnot. But what has been the greatest benefit to you personally of serving in this role? How do you think that you've grown through it?
The best thing I think I've done is just stay out of the way. because I look at the ranks of our volunteers, you know, we've attracted professionals, people, you know, and they're not only this incredible group of guys in their late teens and 20s, but, you know, we've attracted guys that have retired from the airline industry that qualified airline pilots that take, you know, my grandfather worked for the Reading and he lives 10 minutes from me and he loves working on the 2100 because it is such a connection for him with his father and his grandfather. The people that you meet, you know, you get to meet people that I don't think I would have met Doyle McCormick, Gary Benzman, if it weren't for, you know, having the opportunity to help this organization move along through this project. So got to meet a lot of really neat people, make a lot of good relationships and connections, and then get other professionals involved that working on steam locomotives are their thing, you know, and picking their brain. Hey, how would you do this? How would you do that? You know, so been a great learning process. You know, I've been around, you know, steam in the live steam environment, model railroading, like a lot of us. And so this has just been a really cool next step in progression and, you know, what I get to do in my free time. So I would encourage anybody, if you, no matter what the project is, if there's something near you that would allow you the opportunity to get around working on full-size railroad equipment, it's challenging. There's nothing lightweight or easy about it. But, you know, as you start tackling projects and you see them get completed, it gets contagious. The enthusiasm builds. Okay, what are we going to work on next? You know, and I think our volunteers are proof positive of that. You know, the strength of our organization is really rooted in staying focused one task at a time. And when we have the manpower to expand to a second or third task, we just go about it in a workmanlike manner with a good, clear plan of attack, how we're going to do it. And we work till it's complete. So
working till it's complete and then finding a new project to repeat the same process on and building a really exciting future of the process. On that future, Brian J. Smith asks, where do you see the locomotive and the organization as a whole in 5 years?
Oof. You know, obviously, in a perfect world, we'd have our own railroad, our own fleet of cars, our own cute little depot at both ends of the railroad. That, not to say that may develop. We don't really have any plans in the works for something like that. But, you know, in 5 years, I hope we're running the 2100 60, 70, 80 days a year at one or more different venues throughout the Midwest. Wherever we can find willing hosts that would like to have us and we can create the right opportunity for the organization or for the locomotive, we want people to get to experience big steam, right? I mean, it's a really cool thing to stand and have a large locomotive that's 300-400 tons go pounding by, right? So, you know, and I would hope that in 5 years we're working on the 1352 and we're starting to tear into that project and start to, I think a lot of things, you know, we obviously get done with 2100, there'll be a lot of skill sets we will have acquired as an organization that in some ways hopefully will allow the work on the 1352 to go a little quicker because we'll know exactly what to do. We won't have the learning curve on some of the things that we'll be embarking on with that project. So I would see that, you know, hopefully we'll have one or two crew cars, support cars, maybe even a support diesel to go along. But that's kind of a little more the longer range hope that we'll be able to have our own support diesel locomotive, knowing that most places we're going to run is going to be push-pull. We won't be able to turn the engine at both ends. And it'll be a lot easier if we're just dragging a train with our own locomotive at the other end, pull the train back the other way on whatever trip we're running. So if you have a nice 4 or 6 axle locomotive that you're looking to find a good home for, let me know. We'd love to talk to you. So
All of that sounds really exciting, and it's going to be fun to continue to see your progress over the next couple of years, especially as you're tackling these final major projects. Their website is americansteamrailroad.org. If you're listening to this before October 28th of 2023, then you should consider attending their Legends of Steam presentation featuring Steve Wickersham, who was engineer, fireman, and chief mechanical officer for Reading 2101, so its sister engine, and the CNO 614. You can find out again on their website, americansteamrailroad.org, as well as these raffles. You can buy more tickets, or I have even less chance of winning a T1. Rob, thank you so much for coming on the podcast today.
Oh, thanks for having me, Nick. Really excited to spend some time with you and share where we're at with the project and the organization, and hopefully we'll be meeting again with a living and breathing 2100 in the background.
Sounds good to me.
And now, the question of the day.
Last time on the Roundhouse, we were talking to Peter Abbott, the CEO of Puffing Billy Railway, about their Australian treasure of a little narrow-gauge railroad. That led to the question of, what is the furthest you've traveled to go on a particular train ride? From YouTube, Railroad Preserver 2000 says, Alaska is the furthest I've ever traveled to ride a train. I went in 2016 to ride the White Pass and Yukon route. From Facebook, Jason Lee traits, the furthest I've ever gone to ride a train is Garibaldi, Oregon, where I went there last summer to ride the Oregon Coast Scenic Railroad. Sarah Camerod writes, Nevada Northern Railway 2011. And Jake Fry says, the furthest I ever traveled to see a railroad was the Brains-Rothorn-Bahn in Switzerland. Beautiful ride. Your question of the day for this episode is, what steam locomotive restoration are you most excited about? Let me know on theroundhousepodcast.com. Links to social media are there. Thanks for listening, guys, and always fun to have you along for the ride. Remember that the Roundhouse is our house.